they really rock it on the grown-up blues, tight dresses and lipstick, I spoke in high-heel shoes. But tomorrow morning, she'll have to change her trend. Go back to being just 16 and back in class again. Yeah, cause they'll be rocking on the bandstand. Then I get to VA, deep in the heart of Texas.
Eddie Cochran sings Chuck Berry on Boy Meets Girls on the 27th of February 1960. Interesting guitar solo on that, great guitar solo, very much borrowed by Big Jim Sullivan when he came to be the session man on Sweet Little 16, recorded and produced by Joe Meek and sung by Michael Cox. Here's Big Jim.
It was fantastic, you know, it was just great to play with as well, you know. I mean, his guitar was predominant on stage, you know, but he had us to having guitarists like myself and Tony Belcher with the Wildcats doing things contrapuntal to what he was doing. Every now and again I had a solo, you know, because I did some things that were different to what he did. We used to sit down on the train when we used to go by train. We used to sit down on the train and play guitar together, you know, with Joe and Colin Green, because that's where all us guys learnt our trade, basically, you know, or were influenced, let's put it that way. We weren't duffers before that, but after being on the tour with Eddie, you know, we learnt a hell of a lot.
So the final week of the Gene Vincent Eddie Cochran tour is at the Bristol Hippodrome, running up to Easter 1960. In the audience was Pete Purnell, who ironically and bizarrely was probably the last fan to see Eddie alive.
Well, I went to Tuesday night's show and I was so enthralled by it all, I booked again on the Wednesday and then finally on the Saturday when I went with my cousin Phil Hardwell, who lives in Bridgewater now. And on the final night, on the Saturday night, we wanted their autographs, so we hung around outside the Hippodrome and eventually came out, but we had no chance of getting an autograph. They didn't want to stop. So we chased them in our car, I forget what it was, I think it was the Morris 8 now, I think one of my mates had. And we chased them along the Bath Road, thinking they were going to a hotel somewhere, in which case we'd get them for their autographs. But in the end, we'd lost them, they were travelling at such a speed that we gave up on the Bath Road. Somewhere just past Brislington, I think it was, that we gave up. We were going as fast as we could, but we just lost it, you know, and we just gave up, you know, we just couldn't keep up with it. And then, obviously, the next morning, we heard about the accident, you know, which we didn't know about till the next day. So that was quite a quite a shocker.
For that final show at the Bristol Hippodrome, Dean Webb had been taken ill, so his place was taken by another Parnes protégé, Johnny Gentle.
I was in the car that night, and Eddie was on a coach and been doing a tour on the coach, and he wanted to get to Heathrow to go back to the States that evening, or that early morning. Because I was in the car, he said, "Johnny, can you give me a lift? I believe you're in your car. Can you give me a lift to Heathrow on your way home?" I said, "I'd love to, Eddie, but I've got Peter Wynn, who's on the show, and his girlfriend, my girlfriend. So I said, I'd love to, but, you know, I could fit you in, but I couldn't fit Gene and Sharon Sheely as well." So he said, "Oh, don't worry, Johnny." He said, "I'll get a hire car." Well, we know what happens. Unfortunately, on the way home, because they left the theatre before we did, I stopped this constable, because we were low on petrol. I said, "Do you know, there's a garage open." He said, "No, not this time of night, son." And he said, "But there's been an accident round the corner, and if the breakdown truck may have some petrol on it, get to see you on your way." We went round this corner, and we saw an ambulance pulling away. We saw this car on the grass verge, and the breakdown truck trying to upright it to tow it away. So I had a word with the breakdown truck, and I said, "Any chance of any petrol?" He says, "No, we've got none on board, but if you want, you can siphon the petrol from this wreck." We got home, our manager phoned and said Eddie had been in a serious accident. We were all about ready to go, to jump in our cars to go to the hospital and sort of see him. And before we could start on our journey, we got another phone call to say he'd passed away.